Dr. Wilfred Riley is joining me now, assistant professor of political science at Kentucky State University and author of Hate Crime Hoax, How the Left is Selling a Fake Race War, and Taboo, 10 Facts You Can't Talk About. Dr. Riley, thanks for joining me.
Yeah, sure. Good to be here.
Now, before giving away too many spoilers about your two books, I just want to briefly talk about what's in it and why are they relevant to the current political climate?
Okay, well, both of the books, I think an underlying theme for the two of them would be this idea of unreality or this idea of narrative. I don't think it's much of a secret, and you work in it at a fairly elite level, but I don't think it's much of a secret that the U.S. media, which is something I engage with often as a businessman and an academic, tends to be very coastal in its orientation, tends to be very upper middle class in its orientation. I think this is the third most important of these facts, but tends to lean pretty far left. Pew Research in 2000, Collar obviously an exception, but Pew Research in 2004 did what became a pretty famous poll in political science, where they found out that 93% of mainstream media journalists were either leftist or liberals or moderates, with most of the moderates also leaning left. 7% were conservatives of any kind. That includes libertarians. That includes, you know, the fun anarcho-capitalist block of people. That's anything to the right. And I think that because of this, this extreme concentration of what you could call discursive power, if you want to get wonky, and really three or four cities, with my giant hometown of Chicago probably being the smallest, we're very often presented with a series of narratives that just don't match reality. So the book Hate Crime Hoax looks at the undisputable fact that a very large percentage of at least the high profile hate incidents and race violence incidents we've seen in recent years. So you're talking about Jussie Smollett, you're talking about Covington Catholic, you're talking about Erica Thomas, this congresswoman that claimed she experienced a verbal, if not physical, attack at an upper-end grocery store for racial reasons. The alleged attacker turned out to be an anti-racist Cuban-American guy who showed up at her own press conference and told the truth. But moving on, the horrific dreadlock cutting case in D.C., Drake University, Goucher College, Wisconsin Parkside with the nooses, Keehan University with the death threats to every black student on campus. You could probably argue Duke lacrosse, the Rolling Stone alleged rape conspiracy. All of these massive national stories turned out to be fakes. And in general, the uncovering of the fake received far, far, far less coverage than the initial story itself did. So Hate Crime Hoax looks at why this is. And I want to emphasize, I'm a fairly ethical guy, and I say this in every interview. No one is denying that the typical hate crime claim, someone says they were beaten up outside a cowboy bar after closing time, or a tough African-American club as a Caucasian guy, no one denies that's true. But I was very interested in why these high-profile incidents were taken and were highlit by the media, and in the set I just gave, the majority of cases turned out to be complete fakes for that set. And so the book looks at why we are giving power to the concept of victimization. It looks at why this tends to be occurring most often or very often on collegiate campuses. At one point in the book, I go through the first 10 pages of www.fakehatecrimes.org, which is a resource that has an excellent set of these cases that's substantially different from my own. But I look through their cases as well as mine, and I notice that on their first 10 pages, more than a third of the incidents occurred on a college or a senior high school campus. So I look at what we're doing on the university campus. How are we creating this hothouse environment for these sort of fakes? And also for a range of other things, for racial unrest and what really seem to be objectively very anti-racist situations. An epidemic of charges of sexual assault defined very differently from the traditional definition of rape. What are we doing in my new arena, the campus? So that's Hate Crime Hoax. Taboo continues that theme of a narrative being presented that's frankly not real in many cases, and extends it more broadly. So I look at the claims that are made by, for example, Black Lives Matter, which is where I think we're going to go pretty heavily with this interview, that there's a nearly genocidal wave of police violence, and I unpack that. And we'll get to this in a little more detail, but there's not. Last year, the total number of unarmed black men killed by police in the USA was between 9 and 15. Only 1,000 people, 1,004 specifically, were killed by Leos at all. Many of those were actively attacking the officer, aggressing against the officer. Only 229 of them were black. Which is almost exactly proportionate. Black people make up a bit under 15% of the USA, and we have a definitely higher crime rate, at least for violent offenses. Whites dominate corporate offenses. But I mean, so you're not really seeing a huge discrepancy there at all. You're certainly not seeing a wave of murders. So I break that down in chapter one. Chapter two looks at interracial crime in general, which again is something we've been fed. I mean, these cases, Barbecue Becky and Pool Party Paula and Central Park Dog Gate and so on down the line, Coupon Carl. There's one of these silly incidents in the news every couple of days. Is that representative of interracial crime? Is it very difficult just to be black? And again, I find no. Interracial crimes between blacks and whites, and I'm confining this to real crimes, crimes that involve violence, are about 5% of crime. There are 12 million crimes in a year. 600,000 of them are violent, serious incidents between blacks and whites. And speaking frankly, as a black man, we commit in a typical year 70 to 80% of those. There are more whites. They have more money. This isn't even especially surprising, but it's something that needs to be discussed honestly from the standpoint of the African-American community. Not only is there very little of this crime, it is not the case that whites commit most of it against us. These are just facts. So those are the first two chapters. Then I go into other non-controversial topics, different performance across groups in terms of athletics, testing boards like the SAT. I think this is mostly cultural, but it's real, and it very, very significantly predicts, almost entirely cultural, in fact, in my opinion, but that significantly predicts where people are going to end up. It's not necessarily racism that someone with a 950 SAT would wind up at a good community college rather than Harvard. So that's chapter three. And I go on and on with this. What does racism mean? I give the actual definition shared across all dictionaries until yesterday, actually, and point out that anyone can be a racist in that sense of a genetic bigot. I give some suggestions on how to stop racism. But I also note that a lot of the claims in mainstream society, minorities cannot be racist or effectively prejudiced, border on the nonsensical. That segues into the next chapter where I look at white privilege and cultural appropriation. And again, empirically break down the fact that if you want to talk about privileges, there are 8 or 9 things that will affect your performance on a standard income scale or happiness scale more than race. Sex, you might be interested to know, is one of them. But sexual orientation. But moving away from the woke, I mean, IQ, aggression, appearance. So the idea that all whites are somehow privileged in a way that all blacks or Asians are not. Asians, on average, out-earn whites. So do middle-class blacks, separated out as a category. So it would be extremely bizarre, to some extent, for me to tell an out-of-work coal miner in Appalachia, which is very close to where I live right now, that they have some kind of advantage over me as, you know, former business exec and current college professor. It would seem ridiculous. And in the chapter, I point out that to some extent it is, without, you know, denigrating real racism. And so on through immigration. The final chapter takes on some of the claims that you're now seeing in the right-wing media from the quote-unquote alt-right, claims of epidemic black crime, the majority of many people allegedly want to separate from the USA. We hear constantly, do we need a divorce from left and hard right? I look at the idea of ethnostates, and I say that almost all of this is nonsensical as well. What are the practical facts around, you know, race relations in America? And I find they're pretty good. Roughly a fifth of marriages as of last year are now interracial. So the theme of both books is kind of narrative, what we're being told. And because of how rage clicking works, as you understand as someone in the media, what we're often told is intense, frightening things. Not just race stuff, by the way, but your penis won't work. Your plane will fall out of the sky and burn. Your child will be kidnapped. But I'm focused more on the race and gender debates. And I think I do a fairly good job of unpacking, well, this is what Black Lives Matter says, and that's mostly false. This is what left and right say about interracial crime, and that's mostly false. This is what we often hear about immigration. We have a duty to accept essentially anyone. That's mostly false. So the book Taboo is designed to bring the light of truth into areas where it's rarely seen. So it's an empirical analysis of all of the narratives that we see. And there's a lot of criticism directed at the mass media and at my own field of academia in both books. A question I ask at one point in these words is, what's up with discourse? What's up with conversation in America? And I really do feel that there is, frankly, there's an old Marxist idea. It was articulated by a guy named Antonin Gramsci, who said bluntly, communists are very unlikely to become, you know, the dominant line of perspective in the military. We're not going to take over business, which is all about success and competition. We're not going to take over sport. What else is there? Farming. an organized religion. So it's very important to get fringe ideas into those institutions that can transmit them to people. And that would be, I suppose, academia, secondary education. That would be media. That would be the NGO sector, formerly fairly neutral organizations like the ACLU, SPLC. And I frankly think you've seen that happen. You've seen in media like Twitter comes to mind, but also like the very serious discussions that might be hosted by one of the forums I've just mentioned, that it's become very difficult to say the most basic sort of things. J.K. Rowling just got dragged on Twitter, almost left the platform, for saying there are two primary human sexes. However you feel about people's personal gender and so on identification, that's a fact. That's not disputed by anybody, but it has been made taboo to say by the people that control the levers of power. And so this book is designed to some extent, expose who those people are, but more importantly, to break down these are the actual facts that you're not supposed to hear about these narratives. Race war, there isn't one. Immigration policy, we should have one. Men and women, they exist, and so on down the line.
Now, it's been a few weeks since George Floyd's death, but the conversation about police brutality and race hasn't gone anywhere. I want to get your reaction to what's been happening in response to Floyd's death, including what's been happening in terms of the riots, as well as the peaceful protests that seem to be overshadowed by the looting and riots that we've seen in cities and communities across the country.
Yeah, I think I have two reactions. The George Floyd death was a tragedy and probably a murder, but the reaction was profoundly unhelpful and silly, and it was based on one of these false narratives. So first of all, the George Floyd thing. I mean, I lean at least center-right politically. I think you know I'm pro-police, but that was a disgusting display of bad policing. I actually, as a sideline, am broad weapons and fighting is a bit of an exaggeration, but a pistol instructor. I've qualified through the National Rifle Association. I go to the range once a week. Without false modesty, I'm quite good. I'm familiar with how to fight physically. You don't, in general, unless you're trying to kill someone, to use a kill shot, put your knee on someone's neck with them laying in that particular position for 8 minutes. I think that this sort of glib description of this as sort of a racist KKK-style homicide is false. There were four officers on the scene. At most, two of them were Caucasian. I'm still not quite sure about Lane. I've seen contrasting pictures online. But Thao is, I believe, of Hmong descent. There's no doubt he's a man of color. Kung is, I believe, Hispanic and Korean. That's a Korean surname. But I mean, in fact, you had quite a range of diversity there with these officers. Thao was not a junior officer. He'd been on the force for years. And by the way, racked up more complaints than most of his white colleagues. I mean, there's nothing there that indicates to me this was a racialized murder. But that was a disgusting example of bad policing. At least Chauvin, and I'll bluntly say all those guys should face criminal charges. But the question there, a big point there, I think, is that everyone agrees with what I just said. The day after the George Floyd killing, I mean, I consume a range of media. And literally from Tim Weiss on the one end to Ben Shapiro on the other end, I won't attempt to quote either man, but the general thesis was, this is disgusting. Let's press charges. We've had enough with bad cops of all races in these big cities. I will note Minneapolis has had this problem three or four times in the past 5 years, by the way. And it's not just white cops. I mean, there was a Somali American officer that shot an Australian tourist. That became an international scandal. At one point, I recall they threatened sanctions unless something was done against the state. I don't even know how that would occur. And again, that did not happen. But that was a major story. And again, I'd have to check that, but they were definitely angry. They said a lot of things. You know, you saw the Philando Castile case, which is one of the truly traumatizing Black Lives Matter cases just a bit before that. This was an African-American gentleman, had a professional position with the Montessori schools. I believe he supervised the lunchrooms throughout a suite of these schools. He was out driving with his girlfriend, his kid. He was shot. Again, that was a racially diverse group of officers. Geronimo Yanez shot him. So, and now there, actually, it is worth noting that Philando Castile apparently strongly resembled a burglary suspect that had been spotted in the area. This was not just an act of random police violence, but it would be hard to describe it as good policing, right? I mean, there are three or four of these incidents within a couple of years. So I think most people said, we need to take a long look at that department, and we need to punish these officers. This was a universal consensus. Rush Limbaugh said this. Nancy Pelosi said this. So, to me, the incident easily could have been resolved at that point. before the riots occurred, all four officers had been permanently fired and informed they were going to face charges, almost certainly. So the question becomes then, why did the riots happen? And what did the riots accomplish? And I think that there are a lot of reasons the riots happened. I mean, you can't avoid the impact of COVID-19 lockdowns to some extent. I mean, we had decided not to do what the Swedes and the Japanese and for most of the country, what 8 of our own successful states did in response to COVID-19, which is demand well-done social distancing and trust citizens to follow the rules. We decided not to do that. So something like 40% of blue-collar workers were laid off at home with no money. Obviously, when you see the same government that is making you do all this stuff abusing people in the streets, you're going to be much more likely to snap. And I find most people aren't thieves unless they're hungry. You're also going to be much more likely to break into a store and take things if you don't have any food. So that was part of the setup for these riots. But I think that a broader reason that the riots occurred, it gets back to actually what I talk about in Taboo, which is this concept of narrative. Many, many people, especially young brothers and our white allies, believe that there is this genocidal campaign of violence against young men and especially minority men. I will reiterate, there is not. The total number of black people, total, killed while unarmed by police last year was max 15. I don't believe I've given this before as a standalone figure, but the total number of unarmed individuals, as always, primarily Caucasian and Hispanic, was under 60. I believe it was 56. So those are the actual figures. But that is not how the debate is presented in mainstream mass media. Attorney Benjamin Crump, who is the lawyer for Trayvon Martin's family, recently published a book called Open Season, The Legalized Genocide of Colored People. This is an Amazon bestseller, 272 reviews, rated 4.8, 4.9 stars out of 5. And that is the way in which this is often discussed in the mainstream conversation. So I think a lot of people went out into the streets motivated by this, with the names of the quote-unquote Black Lives Matter martyrs on their lips, not knowing that they were actually naming every single unarmed Black person killed by the police over a period of about 5 years. So I think false narrative really played into the violence here. And we need to stop being tolerant of this false narrative being presented in very mainstream media outlets. People need to start writing letters. People need to start calling in. People need to say, this is absolute BS. There were 60 guys killed and the 70, 80% majority of them were Caucasians and Hispanics that are just ignored. There are an incredible number of these white and Hispanic cases, I will say, by the way. While I was writing Taboo, I, again, fairly ethical guy, wanted to make sure the Black cases were not different from the cases involving poor whites and Hispanics. They easily could have been. But if you look through some of these situations, Dylan Noble, Tony Tempa, David Shaver, I believe, could be Daniel Shaver. But if you go through these cases, Ariel Roman shot in the back by two Chicago cops who happened to be Black because he was walking between two train cars and people assumed he might be a tagger. These are just as egregious and ridiculous as anything on the other side of the aisle, the other side of the storyline. They're not discussed. At any rate, I think people who were unaware of the second set of cases, very aware of the first and hungry, took to the streets. And what actually happened? I don't have a great deal of patience for rioting and looting. To some extent, I can actually see why, as a young, quote-unquote, fighting man or woman, you would want to go brawl with the police if there had been violence in the streets. Why you might want to take on a local military unit or something. I think that's a bad, stupid thing to do. They have bigger guns. But you can see ethically why someone might want to do that, and that goes back to the Green Mountain Boys. But the problem with this kind of violence it is that it is very rarely targeted against the state. Throughout this entire period, one police station burned, and that's because the officers intentionally abandoned it in a retreat formation. Almost everything that was destroyed was a series of small to mid-sized, often minority-owned or franchised businesses. I mean, we saw a lot of videos of this target in Minneapolis, but if you actually go through what was destroyed in Minneapolis, there's a full list of this of these businesses available on the Minnesota Live website. And I mean, I read through it and there were places like Plaza Mexico, I mean, the well-known Hispanic American-owned store, Safari Beauty, which is, I would imagine, a Black-owned beauty supply business. A lot of invocations of Africa in the name and some of the products that were sold there. the International Bazaar, I think the name says it all in that particular situation. You know, Midori's Floating World Cafe, Asian food, one of the better known businesses in that part of the city. So a great deal of the middle class Black and Asian business district in Minneapolis was set on fire. I'm not sure what that's supposed to do for people of color in the USA. And this actually, because so many of the rioters were white, well over 40%, I'd say, a lot of Caucasian kids out there in the Antifa ninja outfits, you were treated to this incredible spectacle of a white mob burning a successful Black business while chanting Black Lives Matter. And I don't think that really produced any sort of positive outcome. There's a great deal of writing on rioting, actually, that goes back to the 1960s, that finds that peaceful protest, where people look like they could fight if they wanted to, has a major impact. Seeing 100,000 people led by Dr. King show up in front of the White House and then send an emissary for a pleasant chat is very successful. You understand what could happen, but you also understand you're dealing with civilized fellow citizens. Rioting in general creates a strong backlash effect where, one, people go out the next polling season and vote hard for the law and order candidate. The 68 riots elected Richard Nixon in a landslide. And two, a component of the backlash effect is that businesses leave areas where they think they might be burned down. There's a great deal of excuse making on the political left, which includes the African-American left. So we keep hearing these narratives of food deserts and so on. There are not businesses in these parts of town. I'm from Center City, Chicago. The reason there are not businesses in much of the South Side is that on multiple separate occasions, the pre-68 riots, the 68 riots following the death of Dr. King, the great man, sympathy riots, although a small scale in 92, obviously that was the year of the LA riots, if I had that correct. These riots now, those businesses have been burnt between 2 and 4 times. So if you're a small shopkeeper, you're not going to set up your business in a neighborhood where people are going to break into it and set it on fire. So I don't see that this is going to have a long-term positive impact. I think in Black communities, poor white communities, you're going to have fewer businesses. That's what actually happens when you burn down the businesses in your community. We often, and I'm a long talker, so this will be my last point here, but we often tend to present the 1960s. And again, this gets back to media narrative. Who controls the narrative? Who presents this? We often tend to present the 1960s as an idyllic time of people making love in the streets and smoking foot-long joints, sitting on top of trash cans, reading poetry. Now, first of all, imagine what living in the neighborhood I just described would be like if you're, you know, a young married mom or something. Even that's not all that wonderful. But that's not necessarily the reality of what happened. Many, many positive trends in Black communities and ethnic white communities were derailed during this period. This period saw the growth of the welfare state, the real beginning of the modern welfare state. It saw the 68 riots, which burned an incredible percentage of the Black businesses in the country. It saw white flight, where people began to worry, you know, I assume there'd always been racial conflict between these two groups, but people also played schoolyard baseball together. People after the riots began to worry, are my neighbors going to kill me? Are they going to attack me for racial reasons? You saw massive flight out of the cities, which had previously in the North been rather well integrated. All of this occurred, and so you saw Vietnam, and you saw the first backlash among draft-age men to a war against an actual opponent, the communists, that I think we witnessed in the modern historical past. All of that occurred during the period that's often colloquially known as the 60s, and that had a major negative effect. If you look at where the Black community would be right now, if it had not been for the massive riots that destroyed our business sector several times over, and for the influence of welfare, which played a major role in taking the Black quote-unquote illegitimacy rate from 11% around World War II to 74% today, without those two negative stimuli, I think we'd be about on par with the white community in terms of most measures. Asian Americans certainly are. Unfortunately, that did not happen, and I think that we are now seeing the echo of that 1960s violence again. We're seeing people stoking the same tensions and saying, well, we still haven't quite caught up with them and so on. And the horribly ironic part of that is if widespread rioting in Black business districts happens again, that'll knock the community back another 30 or 40 years. So I'm not very sympathetic toward urban rioting at all. And I don't just want to focus on white and Black, by the way. If you set someone's business on fire, you're a criminal. It doesn't matter if you're a Black rioter that sets a white business on fire. I think that there's been a bit of tolerance of vests and a bit of a tendency to focus on sort of the Antifa bros and the mobs and so on because it's easier. But obviously, we do have laws, and you can't run around in the streets setting shops on fire. So not a fan of that, but also obviously horrified by George Floyd's death.
Yes, you know, it seems very counterproductive that people would go into communities of color, destroy, burn down, damage, smash windows of businesses owned by Black individuals. It just doesn't make sense to me. But anyway, now segueing into another topic that has sparked protests, the shooting over the weekend on Friday night in Atlanta. Two white police officers shot and killed Rayshard Brooks outside of a Wendy's. What's your reaction to this?
Well, one thing I want to clarify, I attended law school at the University of Illinois, ILLINI. Before going on to get my PhD. And what a lot of people don't understand is that if you're looking at a municipal COD certificate, cause of death from, say, the police, any similar agency, there are only about 5 potential causes of death. You know, natural events, you know, natural causes, so on down the line. And one of those is homicide. Homicide simply means an outside perpetrator cause. It doesn't mean that that is a murder that's going to be charged as a murder. So Mr. Brooks, this is something that could be clipped out of context. We'll see if it is. But Mr. Brooks' death was clearly a homicide. Not by you guys, but the question is that a murder, anything along those lines? Probably not, would be my guess. So the Rayshard Brooks case, one of the issues I have with Black Lives Matter, because again, I'm a fairly pro-black guy. I think I differ from some people in that community in that I also like my white and Hispanic countrymen. I think America's obviously been a very successful national experiment. And I think if we were to break it up into small black and quote unquote redneck and Antifa controlled nations, they'd all be third world disasters, every one of them. But at any rate, I am a pro-black dude. I teach at a historically black college. So some of the things behind Black Lives Matter, when I first saw the movement, seemed almost noble. We're going to work on better access to healthcare in black communities. Like, sure, who has a problem with that? But the big issue with Black Lives Matter is that they became very focused very early on this issue of police violence, which, as I said, is not at the national level real, if we want to talk bluntly about it, at least in any sort of broad pattern. And they began to treat every one of these individuals caught up in cases of police violence, like Michael Brown, in many, many cases, not all, as though they were heroes and martyrs. And they began to commingle them. So George Floyd was actually someone who was brutally killed by the police who... you can see people celebrating. This is what we want to fight. This is an example of it. This Minneapolis department, they've done this 4 times or 3 times in a couple of years. Let's kind of make that the banner. Okay, that sort of makes sense. But at the same time, people like Michael Brown are brought into the mix. Alton Sterling, Rayshard Brooks. So Mike Brown is an individual who apparently attempted to kill a cop. There was an extraordinarily in-depth investigation of this whole situation under Barack Obama's Justice Department, fully cleared Officer Darren Wilson. They found Michael Brown's DNA on the trigger guard of Darren Wilson's gun. If you're familiar with firearms, you know the two men had to be wrestling for the gun, literally to the point where they were both touching the trigger and the inside stock of the gun. I mean, had Wilson been shot at all in that situation, that would be an attempted murder or a murder on Brown's part. So, I mean, taking the Michael Brown case and going on with this totally disproven narrative of hands up, don't shoot, this is two big men fighting each other in the middle of the street. I don't see that as helpful in any way to anything. Alton Sterling, similarly, as I recall, he was involved in at least some physical contact with the police. An illegal gun fell out of his waistband during that scuffle. And the reason the police were called is that Alton Sterling had previously been brandishing the gun at people in that neighborhood. This was not an unprovoked murder of a black man. Rayshard Brooks fell asleep in the drive-thru, as I understand, the active drive-thru of a fast food restaurant. And I mean, I imagine Atlanta on a weekend night looks a lot like Chicago. There would be people backed up for a good long way, especially in the time of coronavirus, because this guy was just sitting there. There's not an option of leaving him. So the police show up on the scene, and I've seen the videos. They're quite polite with Mr. Brooks, Rayshard Brooks. Brooks then initiates a fight with them as soon as they try to put the cuffs on. People sometimes have that reaction. Any law enforcement officer will tell you that. Beats up a cop, takes the secondary duty weapon, one of those hyper-powerful police stun guns, from the cop, runs away, behaving in what I think many people would describe as a crazy or a frenetic manner. It's a little bizarre. Turns around and shoots the stun gun, the law enforcement level stun gun, at the officer. He misses his eyes, if you look at the video, by maybe half a foot. And that's when the cop shoots him. Whether or not you think that that was an entirely justified use of force, should he have remained in a retreat posture, partner come up, tackled him, beaten him to the point where you could take him into custody? Arguably, although I think that the officers would have been harshly criticized for that. If you recall the Rodney King situation, I mean, that would have just been the other sort of example of police brutality we've seen widely cited. But at any rate, comparing that to George Floyd is bizarre. There's the Rayshard Brooks case. I would say that probably, I asked about this on one of my social media accounts, and I have a body of followers that includes a good number of law enforcement guys, good number of people I shoot with, good number of legal personnel. And the percentage of people that thought this was an extreme use of force, at least to the point where charges should be filed, was about 10, as versus 90% who did not, because of the facts of that case. I mean, what do you do if someone turns around with what can be a deadly weapon and begins to fire it at you? Obviously, a stun gun or crossbow or something like that's not a semi-automatic pistol. But, okay, I'm being kind of polite here. At the most basic level, obviously, if you beat up a cop, you take his weapon and you shoot it at him, you're very likely to get hurt or killed. So I don't view this as a case where there's really any element of heroism or anything like that whatsoever. Should you put the cop on desk duty, give him weapons or training? I mean, there are arguments for these kind of things. But this is not a black man being murdered for being black. And we're already seeing this type of spin. You know, Rayshard Brooks' crime was sleeping. No, it wasn't. He was sleeping in the equivalent of a public road. The police show up. He fights the cop for 5 minutes, beats up the cop, and attacks the cop with his own weapon. That was the crime that led to that violent fight. So whether or not you sympathize to any degree with Mr. Brooks, that's not on par with some of the things we've seen in the past. And that's a weakness of Black Lives Matter. Like, Michael Brown is in no way a martyr.
Now, you talked earlier about how the media has been fueling the narrative for everything that's been going on. How do you think they responded and covered the shooting of Mr. Brooks on Friday night?
Well, I think that there's a very set narrative that is presented now where, for example, media outlets were told after the first wave of Black Lives Matter cases that it is insensitive to mention the criminal record of a victim in one of those cases. So in a number of the recent ones, it's been very difficult even to find out what that is. The reason this might be relevant is that police now, and this is the sole reason I brought this up with Sterling, by the way, police now have in-car computers. If you are aware of who a suspect might be, I'm not saying they were, and you find out that they've been charged with a number of violent crimes, that can be extremely relevant. Again, I don't know if that would have come up in the Brooks case. Might very well have come up in the Sterling case. But anything about past history we've seen generally vanish in these cases, I think that's fair to say. And I think you definitely see a spin on the narrative designed to make the situation seem as sympathetic as possible. Reading through the coverage of Rayshard Brooks, I saw a great deal of this sort of he was asleep, he was sleeping peacefully sort of commentary. In general, what had actually happened was described as an allegation. People said things like Mr. Brooks allegedly attempted to seize a stun weapon from one of the officers. There's a full video of this that you can find by Googling Rayshard Brooks shooting video if you feel like you're prepared in terms of constitution to do that. There's no allegation there. He beat up the cop, grabbed the weapon, ran away, and shot the weapon at the cop. Weapon narrowly misses the cop. So I definitely think that you see an attempt by the media to kind of not provoke, perhaps left-wing Twitter would come to mind, but to say things very, very properly, not to mention anything that might be relevant in terms of past history or propensity toward violence with the victims, not to mention in detail some of the aspects of the encounter that led to violence. For example, I'm mentioning this only because it's relevant to death. But George Floyd apparently was extremely, extremely intoxicated on fentanyl and methamphetamine, I believe those were the substances, during his altercation with the police. And there's actually dispute at the level of two different autopsies that are going to be brought up in court, whether his death was caused by strangulation from Officer Chauvin or caused by a heart attack brought on by, you know, a stressful physical interaction while he was on all these substances. And while we might not want to talk about that as gentlemen and ladies, I can assure you that the defense attorney that a bunch of long-serving cops are going to bring to the table in a big city is going to bring all this up. And it's important for the media to discuss it, because otherwise people are going to believe, if, for example, Chauvin is acquitted, that he was acquitted entirely because of racism, and cities are born to burn again, and citizens are probably going to, as we saw in LA with the quote-unquote rooftop Koreans, start fighting back, and you're going to see some really bloody incidents. So proper coverage of the news prevents that sort of thing from happening. Even with the Rodney King beating, and I want to reemphasize, nobody is defending crooked cops at all. No one, I'm not a racist, you're not a racist, no one likes crooked black cops, no one likes crooked white cops, all these caveats we now have to use to have these conversations. But the Rodney King beating was in large part the source of riots because of how the media covered it. I believe this was CBS LA that was specifically responsible. The Rodney King tape was about a 2.5 minute tape filmed by one of the many thousands of people in Hollywood that believe they're going to be filmmakers. But this guy took his handheld camera out when he saw the police stop Rodney King. He thought he might get some interesting footage. There is about 2 minutes of King attempting to fight with and escape from the police. He finally falls to the ground, and then, yeah, the cops beat the crap out of him. Like, that, there's no place for that. Citizens might want to do that at the conclusion of something like a fight, but the police can't. Nonetheless, the entire lead-in to this situation, showing King's behavior, showing a fair amount of professionalism on the part of the officers, this was deleted when the TV stations decided to run the tape. So all you saw, you know, down and to the right from different angles for weeks was this poor, unfortunate black man being beaten. And that's what set off the riots. And we run the risk of doing this again if there's not a discussion of, for example, the toxicology around George Floyd, these kind of basic things. George Floyd, again, should not have been killed. But without the ability to have that conversation, many, many lives and businesses could be lost. So, I mean, again, I think that the mainstream mass media is to some extent failing at its most basic job, which is just presenting the facts. The New York Times isn't supposed to be scared of wokies on Twitter. I mean, you are supposed to be able to say, this is what actually occurred. This is relevant because X.
Just a week ago, top congressional Democrats proposed a sweeping police reform bill. What's your reaction to what's inside of this bill and actions by Democrats to address police brutality in America?
Well, first of all, I think that, you know, I lean a bit right myself, but I think politics is a kabuki show. It's almost all fake. The police reform bill actually increases the amount of money given to police in specific blue state big cities. From my read of it, that would increase something like 10% to 16%. So, I mean, first, I would have to see if they plan on doing anything at all. I mean, I'd have to read that full bill and see, okay, you're saying you want mandatory body cameras for all departments. What's the onset date for that? I mean, so a great deal of what the Democrats say to black communities to me is just patronization. Now, I'm not actually going to excuse the Republicans here, who often don't say anything to black communities at all, because the black vote for the GOP is 9% annually. But, you know, it would be very, very much like, for example, Mr. Biden, who is heavily responsible for the 94 crime bill, to say something like, we are absolutely going to fix crooked policing, and then put in, you know, a start date of 6 years from now for some of these programs, or actually increase funding to the police. So I'm not sure the bill does anything. The majority of congressional bills really don't. In terms of the ideas that are being proposed by the current leadership of the Democratic Party, though, just taking them seriously, taking them at face value, I think most of them are fairly bad ideas. One of the core ideas seems to be what's called defunding the police, which broadly speaking, or disbanding police departments, which broadly speaking seems to mean what Mayor Garcetti attempted in LA, where you take, say, 10% of the police budget, I believe it was $150 million in his case, and you assign that to things like social work and mental health services. I think there's a place for social work and mental health services, but we've seen very consistently over the years that the biggest predictor of crime in big cities is how much policing the police are allowed to do. There's not really much doubt about this. It's one of the most robust findings in social science. So in the 1960s, again, this same blessed period of American history, you saw a whole series of changes. Miranda and the Miranda rights, which, to be fair, I think most people support. But Escobedo, the follow-up case, much less popular. Fruit of the Poison Tree, which is a legal doctrine where if the police find absolutely incriminating criminal evidence, but they committed any sort of misdemeanor offense or petty policing violation in order to get it, the officer's not sanctioned or fired. The evidence is thrown out of court. That dates back to this period of time. You saw community policing, where you took a third of the cops and made them coaches for things like the local police athletic league. Charming as all these ideas were, what happened is that crime skyrocketed 500%. If you look at the patterns for a crime like murder between 1950 and 1994, you see what Malcolm Gladwell once called the decline of civilization. You see cities becoming five or six times as dangerous. This extended to rapes. This extended to robberies. Places like Central Park in New York became international jokes as the butt of, you know, comic lines about being death traps. And I actually grew up in Chicago during the tail end of this period. And it was very much like that one movie Kids, quote unquote. I mean, you would ride the trains and see people painting graffiti on them or having sex on the train. Homeless people would wander through at will, you know, asking for money and or demanding it. Fights were extremely common. And this is just traveling through the city. If you're talking about Chicago in 89 or 93, what finally stopped this, and you can talk about population trends. The authors of Freakonomics argue abortion played a role, whatever you morally might think about abortion. But other than a slight effect for population trending, what stopped this was what's called broken windows policing. New York City's police commissioner, Bratton, the mayor, Giuliani, and similar elected officials throughout the country. I believe at that point we had the no-nonsense Daley Jr. in Chicago. People began simply arresting criminals again. So the focus began with quality of life offenses. If you see people urinating outside, which used to be extraordinarily common, or smashing windows just for fun, or doing things like riding bikes down the middle of a packed sidewalk, or smoking weed in public, you would arrest them and take them to jail. And it turned out that this, which is the predecessor of today's often criticized stop and frisk, worked really well at reducing crime, because it turns out that people that are high outdoors making out with their partner while selling small amounts of drugs might also have a pistol or might also have an outstanding warrant. That's extremely likely. So within about 10 years, you had seen crime drop something like 2/3. That was one test example. We then tried this again in 2014 with Black Lives Matter, the first wave. The term that came out of this is Ferguson effect, right? So following the Michael Brown protests, which descended into riots, many police said, okay, well, let's to some extent stop what's perceived as harassing policing. Let's focus on reactive policing, where we respond to calls, we drive around the neighborhood, but we're not stopping and frisking, we're not doing pat downs of young males, we're not breaking up things like dice games. And the results were predictable. In Chicago, I believe one of the black newspapers ran this headline actually, but police stops down 90%, crime skyrockets. There was a direct correlation between the police not going through tough neighborhoods, looking for weapons, looking for cached drugs behind something like lamp poles, making sure people weren't in public violating minor laws, as it turns out, and crime going up. And to some extent, that's because there are environments that are kind of laboratories for crime. I mean, if you have an unregulated gambling spot where people can go take drugs and play cards until 3 a.m. every morning, that's going to be a locus building where you're going to see shootings and stabbings and prostitution and so on. So the easiest way to shut down those very serious crimes is to shut down the location of what might seem like this minor crime. At any rate, I think defunding the police is almost certainly going to result in less police brutality, but three times as much crime. That's what the figures indicate from the past. One thing I will say, again, nobody supports police brutality. So there are things that virtually everyone backs here. For example, body cameras for almost all officers, if not all officers. One thing I'd like to see is a lessening of the power of public sector unions that would allow us to take some of these qualified and conditional immunities out of police contracts. If I, in my role as a local executive, were to shoot someone 8 times, it's very likely I would be fired, or at least I would be on a complete homestay until the conclusion of my case. Police officers generally have some protections against that kind of thing. We need to at least discuss them. What's going to happen with officers that are charged with, say, their second violent criminal violation? So that's an idea. I don't have a problem with some psychological training for officers, PTSD treatment for officers, medication where needed for officers. So everyone wants to do things about some of the problems in policing, But the question is, do we need to get rid of the police? To me, the answer is no, partly because of the data I just gave, but also because of these figures that we started the conversation with. Last year, the total number of unarmed innocents, at least in the Black community they killed, was max 15. So that doesn't sound to me like a sufficient national threat, bluntly, to stand down the police around the country. How many people would that kill? 15,000? There has to be an element of logical analysis to this.
Dr. Riley, one more question for you. Aside from police brutality and defunding the police, another concept that is being talked about is systemic racism. What exactly is it? Where do we find it? And what can we do about it?
Well, so this is an interesting question. Systemic racism is an idea that certainly theoretically could have some value. So racism has traditionally been defined prior to various woke attempted alterations to the dictionary, but in the one I have from last year, as essentially genetically based dislike. You believe inaccurately and to an immoral degree in the genetic inferiority of one or more of the human populations to one or more of the others, and almost invariably as a result, I think it'd be very hard to avoid this, you don't like them or you feel contempt for them. That's racism. It certainly is possible to imagine a system of systemic discrimination or racism that extends out of that. In fact, we don't have to imagine it. I mean, this was segregation. So for years, if you were in the South, I don't necessarily suppose this followed other than at the level of individual restrictive covenants in Chicago or Detroit, but in a third of the country, if you were African-American, you had to live in this neighborhood. Caucasian, you had to live in this neighborhood. Native American, perhaps still a third neighborhood. So that is institutional racism. When you go into the institutional process of buying and repairing a home, you are directed to your group's third of the city. And the different thirds of the city vary in terms of quality of housing, availability of schools, so on. So systemic racism is certainly something that could exist, that has existed. My issue with this term, which I said very openly on Life, Liberty, and Levin the other day, is that most of the time when I see it today, it's used simply to describe differences between groups in performance. So for example, in higher education, one of the things that's described as systemically racist most often is the SAT. And this seems to simply mean that SAT scores are different for different groups. African Americans, we've actually pulled up our score dramatically, but last year on record, averaging 950. Whites were well over 1,000. I think whites broke 1,100 that year, but white scores are generally between 1050 and 1120. Black scores 950. Hispanic scores tend to be either a little below or a little above black scores. Asians kick everybody's ass. I mean, bluntly, that's the easiest way to put it. Asian scores are generally over 1,200. But I mean, people will very often take just the white score and just the black score, ignoring the Caucasian, Hispanics, and the Asians, because that completely ruins the point that they're trying to make, and say, well, what could this be but the result of racism? The reality is that very, very often when you take variables other than race, when you go beyond that sort of crude univariate model you see on both the social justice left and the alt-right, not that those two are entirely equivalent, but they have many ideas in common to a surprising extent. But people are defined by race entirely and so forth. But anyway, if you take variables other than race itself and you add them to the model, most of these differences simply collapse. Fordham and Ogbu, the people who developed the anti-white thesis, two rock-solid black social scientists, looked at this question in 1986 and 2003 and pointed out that black kids on average study less for tests. I mean, it's an extremely clear 0.9 or some such correlation. Youth in our community, and this isn't even entirely bad, but tend to focus more on athletics, social life, potential military career. So you very often have people that are popular, well-liked jocks, but who are not necessarily killing it when it comes to those test boards. And that's something we have to acknowledge and work on. But adjusting for that eliminates almost the entire SAT gap, or at least a great deal of it. Another variable would be living in the South. Test scores tend to be lower for blacks and whites in the South. More black people live in the South, about 50% of our population versus, I believe, 15 to 20% of whites. So when you take a look at these things that are alleged to be systemic, invisible, hidden racism, very often you find that something else pretty obviously explains them. A big variable here that's important is age. So the modal age, important enough figure that some people just call this an average, for white men is 58, black men it's 27. That's just a fact. You can find that by Googling Pew most common age white black men. So obviously, if you're 60 years old and you've moved through college, most likely in an adult successful life, and you've moved into an executive role or a master craftsman sort of role, you're going to make more money than some young punk who's 27, whether that guy's black or white. I mean, you may well be 27. I don't mean to speculate, but I mean, just they're the Daily Caller has staff average of 26, 28. So, I mean, people, you obviously, as you guys go on through 10 or 20 years, you're not going to be making the same amount of money you did in your first fairly elite job. So this is just a bit, hopefully, barring complete collapse, you know, but I mean, so this is just something that people need to acknowledge, people need to talk about. And I find that happens almost all the time with systemic racism claims. There are a few that may have survived. I mean, I do think criminal sentencing, there are some issues. By the time you actually get in front of a judge, if you have any kind of prior conviction, which African-Americans are more likely to, they may not be all that sympathetic. You see some slight differences in traffic stops. But in general, when people make these broad claims, this I guess is my point. When people make these broad claims, not we see a 4% difference with everything adjusted for, but men and women make 60% of what men do for the same work, something like that. You are almost always, you should be aware that that is not accurate. If you actually unpack that wage gap stat, for example, to switch from race to sex briefly, what you find is that the crudest versions of that, where you do hear 60, 61%, include women that are not working because they're homemakers. So, I mean, to some extent, it's just meaningless to say that a rich man's wife's salary is $0. I guarantee you that's not how she thinks of it in Bergdorf's. That's not a thing that is real. If you take this to the next level of analysis, without being glib, where you compare working men and women, already almost a third's been sliced off that gap, but you now have to look at whether people are doing the same job. Are women more likely to work part-time? Are women more likely to stop working and take care of children? And by the time you've gone through all of these differences, you've whittled the gap down to almost nothing, and that's what almost always happens. And I don't necessarily see why this should be surprising. Activists are often in the habit of talking about the USA as though this were 1863 and Jefferson Davis were president. I mean, in reality, the United States of America desegregated, and the South was the only legally segregated region of the country by this point, in 1954. We made most forms of discrimination civilly and criminally illegal in 1964. That's the Civil Rights Act, the first thing you learn about in a law school class. Affirmative action is 53 years old, dates to 1967, Richard Nixon's Philadelphia plan. That's not controversial. Since that period, there's been a massive amount of treasure and sometimes blood expended to try to move these great minority populations, African Americans, Hispanics, certainly Asians quite successfully, into full and fair competition with whites. And it is more than a bit insulting to JFK or Martin Luther King to simply argue that that didn't work at all. No, it worked pretty well. So if you take black and white guys of the same age with the same test score from the same college, they're going to get the same job. It's completely disingenuous to take a young brother from Foothills Community College and a white guy from Stanford and say, well, the white guy earns more money. Of course he does, because he went to Stanford. Now, how about a black guy from Stanford? So I think that when people avoid adjustments that obvious, they're probably doing so for a political reason.